Namaste and good evening, everyone. So today we all welcome you to another interesting topic in the biology series. Today's speaker is Nishant Dixit. He'll be speaking about the classical view of Karma Yoga. He has done his master's in yoga from SPIASA. And today with us is very honorable and very well-known person among you, Yogacharya Dr. Ananda Balyogi Bhavani. He is a recognized PhD guide for yoga therapy, is known to be the first Indian recognized as an IAYT certified yoga therapist by the International Association of Yoga Therapists, USA. He presently works as director of Center of Yoga Therapy Education and Research, CYTER, and professor of yoga therapy at the Sri Balaji Yogpeeth, Pondicherry. He is an honorary international advisor to the International Association of Yoga Therapists, the Australian Association of Yoga Therapists, the World Yoga Foundation, and Gitananda Yoga Associations worldwide. He is currently a member of numerous expert committees of the Ministry of Ayush. He is consultant resource person for the WHO Collaborative Center in Traditional Medicine Yoga at MDNIY, New Delhi. With this introduction, I welcome both our speaker and our moderator for today's talk. And ask Nishant to upload his slide.
Can you see me?
Yes, yes.
Okay. So, thank you, ma'am. And I welcome Dr. Anand Balyogi ji. I am very thankful that he accepted our invitation. So today we have the topic of Karma Yoga, the classical view. So I'll start my presentation. One second. Okay. So the Karma Yoga comprises two words, Karma and Yoga. So first we will see what is Yoga. Many of you have an idea, but I'll give a very brief idea about Yoga. The word yoga comes from the root yuj, which in Sanskritam means the joining of two things. Like in English, we say plus. In Sanskritam, joining of two things is yoga. So what can be the highest joining? That is the Atman with the Paramatman, or the Jeevatman, the individual soul with the supreme soul. That is the meaning of word yoga. Now, there are many definitions of yoga. They might have different words, but their underlying truth is the same. Like Maharshi Patanjali says, yoga is chitta vritti nirodha. Yoga is control over your senses. When you get the mastery over your senses, then you reach a state of equilibrium, a state of equanimity. That state is called yoga. Same way in Katha Upanishad, it is said, Tam yogmiti manyate sthiram indriya dharanam. That when your mind is undisturbed because of your senses, you can control your senses, then that state is called yoga. In Bhagavad Gita also it is said samatvam yoga uchyate. When you achieve that state of equanimity, that is yoga. So they all are different definitions, but they point out at the same, they take you at the same point. The journey of yoga, we have different types of our existence. So the physical body, which is called the sthula sharira. Sthula sharira means this sharira, which is made of gross elements, five gross elements: air, fire, earth, water, space. So this body, this physical body, is made of these five elements. That is called a physical sthula sharira. Then subtler than that, most of the people take this sthula sharira or physical body as themselves, as their real self. But in yogic tradition, we have subtler aspect of our existence. So from sthula sharira, astral body or the sukshma sharira, we link physical body through prana. the vital force, and the mind, the psychic energy. We will be talking about mind in coming slides, so I'm not taking it here. We will take it in next slides. And the ego, that sense of I-ness. Subtler than this, we have the causal body, right? Where we have the samskaras, the latent impressions, our past impressions. And beyond all these three, this is called karan sharira. This is the root cause of the following sukshma and sthula sharira, or the astral or physical body. The karan is our latent tendencies, our samskaras. So that is the karan sharira. And beyond that, when we transcend these states, when we transcend these samskaras, then one realizes his own real self, that unity with the supreme self. That is the state of yoga. That is the target of yoga, you can say. That is the realizing your own real self. We'll be talking more about this in later slides. So if you have to classify yoga, it can be in Bhagavad Gita, it was divided into four parts: Jnana Yoga, Karma Yoga, Bhakti Yoga, and Raja Yoga. So Swami Vivekananda puts it like this, that the personalities are driven with four qualities. Either a person is curious for knowledge. So those who are very curious about all the phenomena which is going on, so they can take the path of Jnana Yoga. Then the Karma Yoga, those who believe in activity, they can take the path of Karma Yoga. Then those who are driven by the emotion, Bhakti Yoga is the path for them. And then last is the Raj Yoga, those who have, they contemplate or they have more willpower, they can take the path of Raj Yoga. Although they are different types of yoga, but in most of these states, these are intermixed. It's like if there is a Karma Yogi, in later stages, he will automatically get the jnana, he will attain the knowledge and also the bhakti or the devotion. So at one point, they all become one. So as we have seen the classification, so in among this classification, we will be taking up the Karma Yoga today. So the Karma Yoga comprises again two words. First is karma and second is yoga. Yoga we have seen. Now what is karma? So karma comes from the root kri, right? So kri means activity. Simple meaning is activity. Now karma means when we perform any action, it's a very simple meaning, performing any action, act. But there is a subtler aspect of it also. It also means the intent. Any karma or the fruit of karma depends upon the intentions behind doing it. Like an army person also kills the terrorist, and terrorist also kills the people. So the intention of an army person is to save their countrymen. So his karma becomes pure. But intention of a terrorist is to terrify people. So his action, his killing becomes wrong. So this is karma. The intention behind any action is very important. Now Swami Vivekananda puts it in a way that the internal fire of the soul and the mental and physical trauma that are inflicted on it to reveal its own power and knowledge are the actions. Like whatever stimulation we get from outside, and now when we experience them, and based on our samskaras and gunas, in coming slide, this topic, this is only we are going to take, we perform any action. So that is how Swami Vivekananda puts it, that it reveals our internal self. Now there are many type of classifications to karma, but like in Bhagavad Gita, it's karma, vikarma, and akarma. Lord Krishna classifies like this, but here we are taking which is relevant to this topic. So it can be divided into two parts: nishkam karma and sakam karma. So in nishkam karma, as the word itself says, nish means the negation and kama means the desire. Where we do not have the desire, that karma becomes the nishkam karma, and the sakam karma, that action which has desire behind it, that is the sakam karma. Now we try to understand the from the classical point of view. So Lord Krishna says, nahi kaschit kshanamapi jatu tishtate karmakrit karyate hi vasha karma sarva prakriti jair guna. So he says, because no one ever remains even for a moment without doing work. So our psychophysical nature is like, we are made, we are manufactured like in a way that we have to perform action. We experience hunger, we experience emotions. So we experience the world. So we experience fear. So so we have to do action. We are made in a way that we have to perform action. We have to perform our duty. We cannot sit idle and live. Right. So, and how we do this action? He says, for all made to work under compulsion by the gunas born of nature. So those who are not from the yogic background, the gunas are three types: sattva, rajas, and tamas. Sattva is a state where it's a very balanced state, where a person is very balanced, very indifferent to the desires, and the illuminous state, the state of light, the state of knowledge. Now the rajas is a state of action, greed, activity, motion, and the tamas is the inert state, the state of darkness. Any object can give you only three feelings: pleasure, pain, or the indifference. All other feelings are the permutation and combination of these three feelings only. So these are the three gunas: sattva, rajas, and tamas. And the nature, the prakriti, is made of these three gunas. So further he says, even a man of knowledge acts in conformity to his own prakriti. So everybody has his own nature, his own prakriti, his own samskaras, and he performs actions according to that. So we'll try to understand these things according to this figure. So we have the self. Self, you can say it is the Atman or the soul or your real self, which is covered by the samskaras. Samskaras means your past impressions, the past latent tendencies. Whatever you have experienced, you have an impression in deep within you. It leaves an impression within you. So those impressions, those latent tendencies are called the samskaras. They are intermixed with the gunas, the sattva, rajas, and tamas, the goodness, the badness, and the inert nature. So this you can also call the your unconscious mind. Now we also have, after this we have antahkarana. Antahkarana, it comprises four forms: the intellect or the buddhi. So this is one psychic energy. This antahkarana is one psychic energy, but it, at different times it behaves in a different manner. So that's why sometimes it behaves like intellect. The intellect is a state where your psychic energy is very decisive. You have viveka, you have buddhi, or the power of discrimination. We say nishayatmika man buddhi, when you have the power of discrimination between what is right, what is wrong, what is Atman, what is non-Atman, what is self, what is not self. So that Nischayatmika stage, that state of discrimination is called the intellect. Then you have mind, the state of fluctuations. Our mind is designed in a way like when we have any thought, performing a thing, this very second thought which comes is, it tries to negate that thought. Suppose you want to come, the very next thought will come that, I should help him tomorrow, or why should I help him? Means it will try to negate it. But the energy of negation depends upon your samskaras, your goodness or your badness, or whatever samskara or whatever guna is prevalent in you, you will act accordingly. But we have those fluctuations, those duality of mind. So in that state, your psychic energy is called the mind, the manasa, chanchalatmika mana. And then the memory is, Patanjali puts it straight, anubhuta vishaya asam prosha smriti. That which you have experienced, but and you have not forgotten, is your memory. And the last thing is ego. Ego, at very subtler level, we assert ourselves. Even it's not that ego, the ego of, or proud. It's the I-ness. Like sometimes we say, oh, I'm an idiot. We can say I'm an idiot. But we might say idiot to ourselves, but somewhere we are asserting ourselves. I am, that feeling of I am, I exist. All the time we have that I-ness, that is ego. So these four forms, the antahkaran. Anta means inner, karan means tool. We have bahikaran, our senses, our mind, our hands, legs, nose, eyes. These are our bahikaran. We have antahkaran, the inner tool. So when we get any stimulation from the world, that goes from our antahkaran to our unconscious mind, or this place where, and then we act according to our samskaras and the state of nas. The action comes out. So if you want to change your action, if you want to change from karma to yoga, if you purify your action, where we have to work, we have to work at this level, at the samskara and our guna level. Like you see the flower. So flower is the manifestation of action which went inside the plant. Flower is not the manifestation of it. It is just the manifestation of the action which went inside. So this action is also the manifestation of your inner being, your samskara, inner state. So if you want to change our action, we have to change at this place, at our unconscious level, at our samskaras, by increasing our sattva, or the way you want to grow. Now, that was about karma. Now, Krishna would say that the root of all the sorrow and conflict of the mind is because of this.
I think there was some internet issue, and he is back.
Am I?
Okay. Yeah, you are back. Please share your slide once again.
Can you see my slides?
Yeah, once again.
Okay, 1 minute.
You can just stop your video feed so that we can hear you clearly. Yes. Yes, we can see it. You can start.
In all the school of Indian philosophies, the cause behind all the pain and sorrow are the desires and the infatuations of mind. So in our traditions, knowledge is always imparted through the stories. And this concept of karma yoga can be understood through this story of Vyad Gita, which comes from Mahabharata. It's a very short story. There was a sannyasin who was doing his dance sadhana in the forest. During that, a bird comes, it makes some noise, sees the bit anger, and it gets burned. So he becomes very proud of himself and become very happy that I have attained this siddhi or this power that if I get angry on something, I can burn. So that time the routine was like this, that those sannyasins were used to go to the city for the food, and they asked food, they beg food from the people of the city. So he goes to a house. There was a lady who was serving his husband. So she says, okay, Swamiji, wait for them. I'm just in mid of something, I'll give you food. So he becomes angry that, you know, she doesn't know that I'm a big sannyasi. So that lady says, okay, don't think I'm a bird and you can burn me. So he becomes shocked. Oh, how this lady come to know that, you know, this happened in the forest. So the lady comes and asks you how you came to know that, you know, that happened in the forest. She says, what you have got, you know, I have got it through the search of my husband and my service performance. I did my duty with the honesty, and this is power. But to know, you need to meet my guru in the market, and he is a butcher shop. He is the Adhyata, is the butcher, but for telling Sanskrit. So he goes to that shop because he was a very curious person. He didn't reluctantly, he goes to the shop, and then butcher was also serving to his customers, but he makes him wait. So he again becomes angry that he's making me wait for so long, and I've got the siddhis and this and that. So this Vyadha again says, don't think I'm a burden, you can burn me. So he again becomes shocked, but it's okay. He waits for him, and then Vyadha takes him to his house. Okay, says, okay, you sit for some time and I'll serve my meals first. He serves his pams, feeds the sannyasi, and then he tells him about the karma yoga. So here are the teachings of Vyadha. So what he says, the astonished sannyasi asked the Vyadha as to how to be so highly illumined by doing a filthy, ugly and menial work. In the eyes of sannyasi, that work is not up to, the mark for a sannyasi. So he was shocked at how he is doing this work and getting the more knowledge than me. So the Vyadha, that butcher replies that because of his past and previous karmas, he was placed in this particular setting. But in he has this butcher shop, a traditional butcher shop from his parents. So he was placed in a setting, and he says, no duty is ever ugly, no duty is ever impure. As I told you about the intentions behind any action. What are your intentions? And it is only the way and the spirit in which the work is done determines its worth. The spirit behind any action is what which creates the fruit of it. Now, the Vyadha advises that all the work must be done with involvement of heart, soul, mind, and intellect, and dedicating the work and result of work to the God Almighty. Means we have to surrender the fruits of action and the action itself to the God. This way we do not create any bondage with the action and we don't suffer. Then he again says that decision what is true under difficult circumstances should be made by sticking to the course of action which leads to the highest good of beings. This service, when you are in a place where you cannot understand what is good and what is bad, what I should do and what I should not do, you should see that what is good for larger, in a larger manner, for more people, what is good for everyone. One should perform that duty which is good for everyone. That and he says that the depend birth and this you know you get the knowledge by your action, by the intention of your action, by the purity of your action. Now the question comes: how a karma becomes karma yoga? So Lord Krishna has said in Bhagavad Gita, "Karmanyevadhikaraste ma phaleshu kadachana ma karma phal hetur purma te sango astu akarmani." So he says that your adhikara, your right is on the doing action only. You should perform your duty. You should not be worried about the fruit of action because you do not control the fruit of action. It is controlled by many other things. So you should do what is your duty, and then let the nature, let the Ishwar or God decide the fruit of it. So what makes a karma into a karma yoga? These are three aspects. The renunciation of doership. When you, Lord Krishna says, don't think you are the karta. Right? He says, prakrite kriyamadani gune karmani sarvasha. That all the works are done by the nature, by the guna. And so one should not attach himself with the action, because once you attach yourself with the action, then you will create the bondage. You will also think about the fruit of the action. And you will, the more you think about the fruit of action, more your desire for that, the more you know, you will suffer if the fruit is not according to your intentions. Then the renunciation of the experience, expectations about the outcome, what I said, and surrendering to God. Once you surrender the fruit of action and action itself to the God, you won't suffer. Whatever the outcome may be, you know, you won't suffer. You will remain in a balanced state of mind. So this is how it works. When you are not attached with the action and the fruit of the action, what you can do is your whole psychic energy will be absorbed by the action itself. You will enjoy the action itself. When your whole psychic energy will be absorbed by the action, that state is a state of meditation. And action will be performed with the increased efficiency. When you do it in a way, you don't think much about the result and you enjoy the action itself. So automatically after the action, you will get once you are not attached with the fruit of the action, you will get a state of equilibrium, regardless of the nature, is whatever the outcome is, you won't be so much concerned about that. And this way you can remain in a positive state of mind. Now, this is how a karma yogi becomes. So Krishna says, karmanya karma ya pashyat akarmadi cha karmaya. The one who sees action in inaction and inaction in action is a wise man. So means the one who gets absorbed in the action, and the action itself becomes very relaxing, a state of non-action, so a state of relaxation. That is, and so that person, he says, wise, is a wise man who sees non-action in action. He does the action, he enjoys the action, he relaxes in the action itself. And when he is not doing the action, the action goes on in his mind. So even while he might be sleeping or resting, but there is the action going on in his mind. So he will remain in a state of action only. Even he is resting, he is in the state of inaction, but his mind is working. And at last, what Krishna says, the one achieves the state where, like, he gives a very nice example that as the many rivers or many type of water falls into the, but it doesn't change the ocean, the flow of the river, the current of the river, and the, you know, whatever it carries, they doesn't change the state of the ocean. In the same way, many desires and wish, whatever these things are, when they are absorbed as the ocean absorbs the river. And at last, I would like to mention this saying by Mahatma Gandhi: the best way to find yourself is to lose yourself in the service of others. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Nishant. I would like to welcome Dr. Yogacharya Dr. Ananda ji to please give comments on this wonderful presentation.
First of all, congratulations, Nishant, a very beautifully made presentation, and you managed through the technical issues also to keep going. That is the spirit of yoga, that obstacles may come in our life, but the obstacles should become stepping stones to our effort. And I think one thing which I really liked about your presentation was you have stressed on intention. The intention is the difference between something being karma yoga or not being karma yoga. It is not the actual action. It is not that doing puja is karma yoga and cutting goats by the butcher is not karma yoga. That is why that story is so important. Because we often think the spiritual activities, well, so they are all sattvika and the others are rajasika and tamasika. But the act of being rajasika, tamasika or sattvika is not determined by the act, but the intention behind the act. And this is why you have stressed on that term intention, which is also the basis of yoga sadhana. Maharishi Patanjali, he has told us that yoga sadhana abhyasa must be satkara. He says, if it is to be abhyasa, satu dirga kala nairantarya satkara asevito dhrida bhumihi. He says it has to be satkara. If your abhyasa is not satkara, it is not abhyasa. If your action is not with a satkara, it is not karma yoga, it is akarmani. And you may be seen to be doing. That is why that balance in the Bhagavad Gita, you are seeing the dualities happening at the same time. Seeing inaction in action and action in inaction. The akarmani in karma and karma in the akarmani. That is the duality that you are seeing. And you would have seen in the Taoistic philosophy, they have the two apostrophes, the black and the white. Inside that black apostrophe will be a white dot. Inside the white apostrophe will be a black dot. It means that the dualities are coexisting. And as long as you are caught in the dualities, you will never be free. the dvandva, the duality will imprison you. They will put you into bondage. And that is called raga dvesha. I think that is the only thing I would say is missing from your presentation. The concept of raga and dvesha are driving our every action. If you ask somebody, why did you do it? Because I like to do it. Why didn't you do it? Because I don't like to do it. So the like and the dislike, raga and dvesha, are driving all our actions from the time of getting up in the morning till the time of going to sleep at night. So raga and dvesha, the dualities, are constantly pulling us apart. And this is part of our limbic system. That which is giving you the reward and that which is giving you the pain. Reward and pain centers are primarily your limbic system activities. And so your emotions are driven by that which gives you pleasure, that which gives you pain. Raga, dvesha. And that is why karma yoga has to transcend raga, dvesha. You are not doing karma yoga because you want to do it, or because you have to do it, or if you don't do it, you will get punished. You are doing it for the sake of doing. That is why Krishna's message which you shared, your justification, your scope of practice, I use this word in medical terminology, your scope of practice is the action alone. Karmanyeva adhikarasya. Your scope of practice is the action, not the fruit of action. And again, Krishna reminds us, because you are not going to get rewarded for it, don't go into akarmani. Most people, if I'm not going to be graded for this presentation, why should I do it? If these marks will not count in my final assessment, why should I submit the assignment? It shouldn't be like that. So I really love this way you have presented it. And one more comment I would like to make is the word karma. See, karma is often given a very negative connotation. People say, oh, it is my karma. As if it is a bad thing. Karma is always understood as being bad. Karma is not bad or good. Karma is simple effect of the cause. Cause is also karma. Effect is also karma. Because karma, kar means to do. Ma, who's ma? Me. So karma means what I do and what comes back to me as a result of what I do. So both the action and the reaction, the cause and the effect, both are karma. And this is why if you want to mitigate karma, if you want to ameliorate karma, the vaccine against karma, now everybody wants a vaccine for COVID. The vaccine against karma, the antidote to karma is to perform your dharma. Dharma is living in a responsible way, doing what you need to do because it is what you need to do. You are a human being, be a good human being. You are a father, be a good father. You are a student, be a good student. You are a husband, be a good husband. You are a professor, be a good professor. Whatever you are, be the best you can be at that point of time and continuously work on self-improvement. So karma is both the doing as well as the undoing. I like to say the doing and the undoing, the cause and the effect is karma. So I would like to congratulate Nishant on this excellent presentation. I was enjoying listening to you and watching your beautifully prepared slides. Initially, you were a little tense. I don't know whether I contributed to your tension by being here also, but a little bit that chitta vritti, instead of talking of chitta vritti, you're talking of senses when you talked about chitta vritti. But that is understandable. Stage fear is something that comes in, but you are doing well. So let's go on if there are any questions or anything that people would like to ask at this point.
Yeah, please have put forward your questions. Maybe Prashant or Sheetal can ask something.
Hello. Am I audible?
Yes. Yes, Prashant.
Okay. Nishanji, I want to ask that you discussed about the four types of yoga, Gyan Yoga, Raja Yoga, Karma Yoga, and what type there are, you discussed about the four types of devotees. So are the four types of devotees Artharthi, Jigyasu, Jnani is same or it's other concept?
Is another concept. That is the type of Jnana Yoga, how people want knowledge. You know, that is the philosophy, that how people want knowledge. So some people want it for the artharthi, for the sake of some matterly gain. Then Jigyasu, who want the knowledge. Last is the Jnani, the one who is that for the sake of knowledge. I think Bhagavad Gita better can put it in better words.
Yes, actually, your question is a good question, because when you see four types of yoga and four types of devotees, you think, okay, there must be one for one. But what I would like to say is that we as a human being, we go through multiple stages of development. So one part of our life will be a life where in that part, that period of my life, Jnana Yoga will give me fulfillment. At another part of my life, Karma Yoga will give me fulfillment. At another part, Raja Yoga. So the thing is that not just different people, but the same person in different stages of their life will find that a different yoga gives them benefit. And my mother, Yogacharini Meenakshi Devi Bhavanani, one of the great yoginis of the whole world today, she used to say, initially I liked Hatha Yoga, I liked all of this, even Jnana Yoga was a thing. She says, now I realize Bhakti Yoga is the best. So this point of her life, now she's 77, she says Bhakti Yoga gives me maximum fulfillment. So what we need to understand is this concept of four yoga is not four boxes. They are all interrelated. They are like four boxes, but they are interconnected. Jnana Yoga feeds Raja Yoga. Raja Yoga feeds Bhakti Yoga. Bhakti Yoga feeds Karma Yoga. Each is feeding each other. And at different times of the day, different times of your life, these aspects will sustain that mumukshutva, the burning desire for kaivalya or liberation in you. So rather than think of different people needing different yoga, we need the different aspects of yoga to become that oneness. Ultimately, the goal is oneness.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much, sir.
So I have one question. Maybe it's a little bit off the topic. The question is, in today's world, when everything is so fast and we have so many tasks doing at the same time, so at this, at the pressure of the workload, how can we calm ourselves?
I think the key is the breath. See, the mind goes into overactivity. The faster the mind goes, the more the stress. And if you want to slow down the mind, the only way to work with the mind, you cannot go and work with the mind, because if you try to work with the mind, it will run away. It is like that mirage. Or I like to tell the young boys, it's like that girl, you are going after her, the more you go, the more she'll go away. Or the reverse. What you have to do is you cannot do direct attack. You have to do indirect attack, which is the Indian style. Indian style is always going around, beating the bush and getting the matter done. And not Sida Sada. So dealing with the mind is very difficult, Sida Sada. Because that mind will run away. So how do you deal with the mind? You deal with the breath. And that is why the Hatha Pradipika tells us so beautifully, Chale Vate Chale Chittam. You have to work through the Vate. Here the term Vate implies the breath. And that is why the key to reducing stress, the key to clarity of mind, what is called prasadam, prasadam adigachati, it is said. And the key is through the breath. When you start to regulate the breath, you shift from the brainstem driven respiratory impulses to cortical driven respiratory impulses. I'm talking neurophysiology here. You are changing your whole pattern of breathing from brainstem control to cortical control. The moment you change from brainstem to cortical control, all the stress starts to become the mountain becomes a molehill. And that is why the key in modern times is deep, slow breathing at the rate of 6 per minute. The formula is 6 breaths per minute. And if you get that formula going, your emotions and mind are much better controlled. That is the key.
Thank you. Thank you so much. If anyone else has question.
Yes, ma'am. Good evening, sir. Pooja here. Sir, I want to ask that sometimes we cannot differentiate between our ego and self-respect. So how do we know that it's our ego or self-respect?
Very good question. And it's very tough. Because the ego is like the very smart villain of Hindi movies. And this smart villain will find a way to play on your thought process. It is called Bhranti Darshana in the Yoga Sutra. One of the obstacles is Bhranti Darshana. And the ego tries to masquerade. It puts on the costume of your self-respect, which is Swabhiman. And here we have two things. One is Swabhiman, Swabhiman. Second one is Hina Bhava, which is the negative ego. I am no good. I am no useful. My life is so bad. Nothing works for me. It is called Hina Bhava. And from Hina Bhava, you have to come to Swabhiman through a concept called Pratipaksha Bhavanam. Again, Maharishi Patanjali teaches this. Adopting the contrary attitude with the power of emotions. You are using the power of emotions in a very constructive way. Now, how do you know the difference? Is it your ego or is it the inner voice? I always say one gold standard here, which I adopt in my own life. If it is telling me to do something in line with the Yama Niyama, the Yama Niyama are the foundation of yoga that make us an Adhikarin. They are the Adhikara Yoga. So when your inner voice is speaking to you, it will be in tune with the Yama Niyama. When it is the ego, it will be out of tune with the Yama Niyama. Again, Maharishi calls that out of tune ego as Vitarka. He says Vitarka. For example, one of the Vitarka is Himsa, violence. Now, if your something from inside is saying be violent, definitely it is your ego. It is not your self-respect. It is not the inner voice. Because it is contrary to the principle of Yama Niyama. Yama Niyama principles are the principles of being a good human being. And if you're not a good human being, nothing else is going to matter in your life. So the question I ask myself, whenever there's a voice guiding me from within, if it is in tune with the five Yama and five Niyama, then I know it is the inner voice. When it is out of it, I know it is the inner noise, not the voice. The difference is the voice and the noise. The noise is the ego. Be careful of the noise. The noise is a distortion. The voice is the clarity.
Thank you so much, sir.
Any more questions?
That's a very good mechanism. That's a very good mechanism to deal with inner self.
I enjoy these type of questions because these are the questions that enable us to know what yoga really is. Yoga is not the physical exercise. Yoga is the tool to attain tranquility of the mind. Because if the mind is not tranquil, nothing else can happen. As long as your mind is agitated, you will not be yourself. And if you want to be yourself, you have to have tranquility. That is what is very, very important. Prasanna Atma Indriya Mana, as Sushruta tells us, if you are to have health, there has to be Prasanna Atma Indriya Mana. Tranquility, peacefulness of the Atma, the senses, and the mind.
So as you were explaining, you also talked about Heen Bhavna word. So how to convert this Heen Bhavna within ourselves toward a positive aspect?
Absolutely. Good question. See, Heena Bhavana is the negativity. So whenever we feel sad for ourselves, whenever we feel that we are worthless, whenever we feel our efforts are not making a difference in the world, what we need to know is we have to go back a little bit, like zoom out, because the negativity is like zooming in. You are looking at the microscopic vision, and so you are not seeing the bigger picture. And so you think this is no good, this is no good, this is no good. So the most important thing is to zoom out your perspective, and that is the process of vairagya, non-attachment. Non-attachment, which is metacognition, is where you have to take a step back, and in taking that step back, you look at the bigger picture, and automatically you realize, yes, it is making a difference, which you didn't realize because you were looking at the wrong thing. What I always tell people is, say I go to a class, and in that class, now, for example, in the Zoom session, there are 9 people on screen. Now, if I am turning this side and I'm saying, nobody has come to the Zoom session today, nobody has come to the Zoom session, you will say, Dr. Ananda, you're looking in the wrong direction. What I need to do is I need to change my perspective, and suddenly I see there are 9 people here, right? So what has happened? Often we are looking in the wrong direction. Heena Bhavana is often looking in the wrong direction. We need to change our direction of perspective. And the moment we change our direction of perspective, that is where the yoga practices come in. Doing the asanas, you get a new perspective of your body. Doing the pranayama, you get a new perspective of your breath and emotions. Doing the meditative contemplative practices, a new perspective of the mind. Living the yama niyama, a new perspective of life itself. And suddenly you start to realize you are not a nothing. You are now here in the present moment. And you start to grow from being alone to all one. Alone, A-L-O-N-E becomes A-L-L-O-N-E. From alone and lonely, you become all one. And that is the journey from Heena Bhavana to Swabhimana Bhavana. A very beautiful journey, Pratipaksha Bhavana.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much. Nishant, you had any question? Hello? Can't hear you.
Hello, sir, answered my query.
Yeah? Okay.
Sir, answered query.
Okay. Okay. So, if anybody else have any question, then... I think there are no more questions, sir. And thank you so much for joining us today and enlightening us thoughts and clearing some of the issues which everyone asked. And thank you, Nishant, for giving such a wonderful presentation and explaining it so well, so that the people who are not involved in yoga can also understand it. Thank you so much. With this, I'll say good night to all of you, and we'll meet on Sunday for another of the talk of Balaji series, which will be last talk for this series. Thank you.